In this video, I will walk you through all the features of ray dynamic texture. I will show you how to set up a texture palette and texture with it, and also how you can get quick access to your most used assets like effects, shapes, and expressions. Now, ray dynamic texture is very similar to ray dynamic color, but instead of having a color palette with color swatches, we'll have a texture palette with texture swatches. Now, to create a texture palette, I first need to select some files. So I'm just going to select three images from my project window and click on the plus button. And that will create a new texture palette. Now you can see that we get three swatches up here, and those three swatches represent the three layers that we imported into this palette. And if I change this layer to yellow, you can see that the colors of these swatches directly represent the color of the layer. And you can also see that the character in the swatch is the first character in the layer name. So that can quickly remind me that this is the wooden texture. And if I'm not sure, I can always hover over the button, and then that will tell me exactly what the name of that layer is. Great, so with that set up, let's create a new composition. And when I click on this button, you can see that we get that exact layer into our timeline. So this is a very quick way that you can store some of your most used textures and files and directly call them into your comp. Now the cool part is that if I create a new solid layer, and let's call this solid. Now when I select this layer and then select the swatch, then the wooden texture will become a texture of this solid. But we'll talk more about that in detail later. Let's first take a look at how else we can add textures to our texture palette. So one way I can add textures is just dragging a file in here. And when I refresh, that image sequence now shows up. Another way to do is it directly from the timeline that I'm working in. So if this is a texture and I want to add it to the palette, I can just select it and click on this button, and that will add it to the palette. Now there's also a quick shortcut for removing these layers from the palette, and that's the same shortcut that I would use if there was an expression on this layer. If I hold Alt Shift and then click on this stopwatch, the expression will be gone. And that's the same for these swatches. So if I hold Alt Shift and I click on this, that layer will be removed from the palette. Now I can also go into this palette and start organizing this palette however I like. So I can change the order of the layers, for example. Another thing that I can do is rearrange these textures a little bit, because everything is kind of stacked on top of each other and it's hard to see what textures we have in this library. So I could just quickly resize some of these, and then we're able to see them a bit better. Now, if you have way more textures than this, you can either make this composition bigger so you'll be able to fit more textures, or you can add more frames to this composition and then decide to have all the brush textures on frame one and have all the wood grain textures on frame two, and maybe all the image sequences from frame three. Now, another thing that I can do is create text layers to indicate what some of these brushes are. And this is especially helpful if I'm sharing this texture palette with someone else. Now this is obviously not a texture, so one thing that I want to do is make sure it doesn't show up in my palette, and I can do that by making it a guide layer. And then that way, you won't see it here. So you can customize a texture palette however you like. Now you might think, okay, well, we just changed this size of the texture to 25. What happens when I apply the texture? Well, if I import this texture, it will just come in at the normal scale. If I set a keyframe, however, this texture will come in at that scale of 25, and the keyframe will be gone. Now I can also go back to the palette and set another keyframe for 100%, and now this texture will scale from 25 to 100. And when I import that, it will come in with those keyframes. So I can even store animated textures. So textures can also carry settings, and that's what makes this so powerful, because you set it up once and then you just keep applying it. So we've already seen that you can add keyframes, but you can also add other things like effects, blending modes, and layer styles. So let's go back into this texture palette and let's remove the scale keyframes. I'm going to apply a noise effect of 5%, and I'm also going to set the blending mode to multiply. And we're going to set the opacity to 50. And I'm going to apply a keyframe so that that value will be set. right? Let's go back to comp one and let's quickly color this so we can see the multiply happening. So now I'm going to select this layer and click on that same texture. And now our layer will come in with the noise effect, the blending mode on multiply, and the opacity is set to 50. Now let's have a look at parenting. So if I grab this original solid layer and I start moving it around, you can see that the object moves, but the texture stays in one place. If I want the texture to be stuck to that object, what I can do is I can manually parent it to the object, and now when I move it, it will be stuck. Another thing I can do is before I click on this texture button, I can hold the shift button. And what that will do is it will parent the texture to the original object for you. And if you forget that shortcut, you can also see it in the tooltip. Now there's a couple of ways to texture in After Effects, and by default, Radiodynamic Texture textures with an alpha mat. Now if you want to use luma mats instead, you can just click on this button and then it will change to luma mat. So now when I texture this, it will do a luma mat instead of an alpha mat. Now set mat is also supported, but I'll cover that in a separate tutorial because it's more of an advanced setting. So let's turn it off for now. If I hold option click, it will invert the mat. And now when I texture this layer, it will give me an alpha inverted mat. And that brings me to the next button right next to it. With this button, you can invert the selected mat. So when I have this texture selected and I click on invert, it will invert my texture back to alpha mat. You can also swap out this texture for a different texture. Now in After Effects, you can hold Alt and then grab a different file and then replace it for the layer that's selected. With Radiodynamic Texture, you can do the same. So if you select your layer and then hold Alt, you can choose any of the buttons to replace that selected layer with. Now let's take a closer look at this clone mat. This layer is pretty much just an exact duplicate of the original layer that is being used by the texture to pull a track mat. Now this layer will always be a clone of the original layer. So whenever you move the position of the original layer, the clone's position will move as well. And that's because there's all these expression links that keep this layer at the same position as this layer. Now that will bring me to the next button, which is the clone button. And that will generate this layer on its own for us. So if I select my original object and click on the clone button, I just get an exact duplicate of this layer. Now that's just texturing with one object, but we can also texture multiple objects. So if I duplicate this layer a couple times, like this, and then even move them at separate times. And now in selecting them, instead of texturing with a still texture, I'm going to texture it with an image sequence. And now you can see that Radiodynamic Texture textured everything with that image sequence. And it also trimmed the in and out points of every texture and every clone. And because this original layer was a little bit longer than the image sequence, it also applied a timer map with a looping expression so that this texture keeps looping forever. Now that's very powerful, but now all these textures are the same. So I'm also going to introduce something called smart comps. So for this, you don't need to know any coding. You could just import a smart comp. And when I open up this composition, you can find that inside of that, there's a couple of different textures. And when I go back to my original comp and I texture all these layers with the smart comp, you can see that every block gets a different texture. There will be a more in-depth tutorial on how this works and where you can download these smart comps. Texturing is the main functionality of Radiodynamic Texture, but you can also store effects, shape layers, and expressions. And in combination with textures, this can be extremely powerful. I'll show you how to add effects first, and then shapes, and then expressions. Now we've already seen how effects come into your scene when they are applied to textures, but you can also import them separately. So let's start over and get rid of these swatches with Alt, Shift, and then clicking. So when I add an adjustment layer, and I call that noise, I can select a effect and drag that noise on here, and then I can add that adjustment layer to my palette. And now you can see that this shows up as a circle, and what that means is that this is an effect instead of a texture. So if I delete this noise layer and I click on this noise layer again, that same layer will come back into my project. Now, if I happen to select another layer, like this layer, for example, that doesn't have any effects on it, and I click this button, then just the effect will be applied to that specific selected layer. And I can also select a whole bunch of layers and apply that same effect to all of them. Now, there's also a way where I can make the noise the main controller for all the other noise effects that I apply. So for that, I'm going to release all the effects from all these layers, so there's no effects left on this layer. And then I'm going to go into the texture palette and I'm going to my noise effect. And in order to make this work, I need to apply a special expression to the property that I want to be a controller. So if I open up this triangle here, I can see that this should be turned on. Link this property.value. And when this is on, I can start typing this property.value into this property, or I could just simply click here and it will apply that expression for me. So now that we have the expression applied to this property, if I go back to my composition and start to apply this effect to all these layers, I can see that the value is currently 0. But when I go back into the texture palette and change this value to 10, and then go back to the composition, you could see that all these effects have updated to the value 10. So whenever you put this property.value in any of the properties in the texture palette, they will become the master controllers for any other property that you apply it to. Because as soon as you apply it, the this property.value link will be changed for a link towards the texture palette. Now it's just as easy to store shape layers in the texture palette. So if I go here and I quickly draw a shape layer, I can click on this and add it to the palette. And then this will show up as a square with rounded corners, so you know it's a shape layer. And if I delete this layer, I can pull this right back into my project. Now if I already select a shape layer and then click on this, it will add another ellipse to this same shape layer. Now, one thing that this is a really good use for is repeaters and trim paths. Let me give you an example by importing this project that has a lot of shapes in it. And then let's refresh the script, and then I'm gonna select shapes. And let's have a look in this texture palette. So here you can see that I have a shape layer that only has a repeater on it. So when I go back into my working comp and I select this layer and then click on the R for repeater, it will add that repeater to this shape layer. And that's a very quick way how I can make, for example, a long shadow. Now you're able to do a lot of things with just one shape layer. So over here, for example, I have an asset that I used in my intro that is this 3D sphere. And this is a shape layer that I set up with a couple of sliders that will make it look like this is a 3D ball. So this is an asset that I use a lot, and it's very easy for me to just import it that way. I know I have it stored in an After Effects project here, so I just import it, and that way it becomes accessible to me via the dropdown. Now lastly, I can store expressions. So if I want to make this sphere wiggle, I can add an expression to this called wiggle. And then now it wiggles. Now instead of typing that expression out every time I want to use it, I can select the property and save that to my texture palette. So now if I have any other layer that I import into this comp, I can just select that position property and apply that expression directly. That should get you started with Radynamic Texture. Make sure you subscribe to this channel to receive updates about upcoming tutorials. And check out my new website, georegulus.com, where you can find a lot of free stuff like textures and color palettes for the tools that I make.